What do quasars tell us about Bell's theorem? What is Bell's theorem and what are quasars as well?
Good. So let's start with what is Bell's theorem. Bell's theorem is just a landmark of modern science. And I say not just modern physics. I think it's broader even than that for its intellectual sweep. It's merely 6 pages. It's a very elegant and brief journal article. It rewards rereading to this day. Bell, I think, was an exceptionally careful and disciplined writer. It's very clear. He wants to make his assumptions as clear as possible. It's clear. The article that we're talking about is called On the Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen Paradox. He's clearly referencing the so-called EPR paper, which had come out almost 30 years prior to that point. And Bell's article was published late in the autumn of 1964. Okay, so we just passed what? I guess its 60th anniversary, I guess, right? So it's been with us for a while.
Mm-hmm.
In this very brief paper, John Bell was concerned not so much about quantum theory per se, but about possible alternatives to quantum theory in the language that was then known at the time as hidden variables theories. So inspired by work by people like Albert Einstein and other architects of quantum theory, like Erwin Schrödinger, who came to be very skeptical and dissatisfied with what we might recognize today as kind of ordinary or orthodox quantum mechanics, Bell wondered, was there any way to put into a quantum-like framework a way of describing or ascribing to quantum objects definite properties prior to and independent of our measurement of them? And if so, could those properties also nonetheless obey what we might call kind of locality or local causality? Is there a way to make quantum mechanics look more compatible with relativity, where nothing travels faster than the speed of light, that's the locality, and in which there are really are definite properties to little bits of matter that we can attribute whether we perform a measurement or not? And those were guiding principles that people like Albert Einstein thought should be part of any acceptable physical theory, and Bell thought those were awfully reasonable principles. So Bell's wondering, what would it take to develop a theory of the microworld in which those elements held true, where you could attribute properties to particles ahead of time, before measurement, and in which local events yield only local outcomes, local causes yield only local effects, let's put it that way. And he winds up formulating this very, again, very succinct, very elegant framework, and finds that in any putative theory of the microworld in which those two postulates hold, then there's an upper limit to how strongly correlated the outcomes of measurements can be on any pair of particles if they had been prepared together but since traveled apart. So he has in mind the EPR paper, Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen. He's thinking about what we would now call pairs of entangled particles, and he's wondering, If a theory of nature is going to have these very reasonable sounding attributes,
mm-hmm.
objects have their own properties, nothing travels faster than light, then what are the implications empirically for things like performing measurements on pairs of particles that have traveled in opposite directions far apart? And what he derives is an upper bound, that's why it's an inequality, on a measure of how correlated the outcomes can be, even in principle, on measurements and questions we might ask of each of those particles, if the theory describing them obeys sort of Einstein's preferred postulates. He finds there is an upper bound, and then he goes on very quickly to show a now standard calculation in ordinary quantum theory. The quantum theory predicts stronger correlations, that if you prepare particles in a particular quantum state, let's say, a quantum singlet state for two particles, a classic entangled state, shoot those particles in opposite directions, perform measurements in different bases, different choices of what to measure on each side, that for clever choices of the quantum state and clever choices of the measurements to be performed, the outcomes of those measurements can be more strongly correlated. They'll line up much more often, dramatically more often, than any Einstein-like theory could ever allow. So that quantum mechanics does not obey this conjoint pair of postulates of basically what became known as local hidden variables. So that's pretty amazing. So, and he also says, now he was a theoretical physicist, but he realizes this is in principle something that could be measured in a laboratory. So this becomes known as Bell's inequality or Bell's theorem, such that there's an upper limit to the degree of correlation and behavior of particles if they're obeying these local causal relationships. And then several years go by before pretty much anyone pays any attention. One of the first to pay attention was the then very young experimental physicist, John Clauser, who got very excited about this. He saw the implications right away. He was a PhD student at Columbia University at the time in the late 60s and was very actively discouraged by his PhD advisor to pay any attention to this. He was disparaged as sort of mere philosophy.
Why?
I think the general question or the topic of the foundations of quantum theory generally, let alone very specific topics like Bell's theorem, were really out of favor, out of fashion throughout the physics community, especially in the U.S., though not only in the U.S. at the time. I've written a bit about why I think that was the case. I think it has as much to do with intellectual trends as with institutional changes in the way physicists were being trained coming out of the Second World War. And again, I'd be happy to talk about that. But for a confluence of reasons, Clauser was of that generation, of the few generations, they were actively discouraged and sometimes really in very strong terms from pursuing any of these questions at the foundations of quantum theory, including Bell's inequality. So Clauser then finished his PhD on a different topic, got his first postdoctoral appointment, and then kind of was curious to go back to this question that had now been lodged in his mind for 3 or 4 years. Could one really do an honest-to-goodness laboratory test of this Bell's inequality? After all, he was, by that point, a really very well-trained experimental physicist. So he wrote directly to John Bell in 1969 and said, has anyone done this experiment since then? You know, I was told not to. Has anyone done it? And Bell wrote back with great excitement, saying it was among the first questions he's gotten from any physicist in the world about this work.
Wow.
4 years later. And Bell confirmed no one had done the experiment. Few people showed any interest at all. It would be amazing to do it. And as famously, Bell concludes his private letter to Clauser, if you find results that are different from quantum mechanics, that would shake the world. That's the phrase that Bell had used. The stakes seemed high. So Clauser was fired up and he worked with, teamed up with a small number of like-minded colleagues to pursue this. And again, happy to go into more of the history, but that was really that's the kind of Bell's inequality part. Okay. Now let's fast forward a little bit. It turns out that Bell's theorem is a mathematical theorem, which means it depends on starting assumptions, right? And so do those assumptions hold in the real world? If you're going to do an experimental test, you have to show that your experiment is consistent with the starting assumptions and not just that you found some results any old way. And so what Bell himself and Clauser and others like Abner Shimon and a whole list of people in the mid-70s began to realize and identify is there are all these kind of what came to be called loopholes that have to be addressed in any given experiment if you're really going to conclude that the strong correlations that you presumably are going to measure are because of a violation of Bell's inequality. That's to say, there are all kinds of subtle, sometimes weird-sounding scenarios in which a perfectly Einstein-like theory, perfectly consistent with local hidden variables, could yield these very strong correlations. One obvious one that Clauser and Bell themselves wrote to each other about, right, in the early years of this, would be if information could be kind of flowing throughout the experiment, if information could be leaking from one side of the test to the other, if one particle is measured here, let's say particle A is measured here, and then enough time goes by so that a single light signal could have traveled from here to there, just at the speed of light, nothing fancy, and then later you measure properties of the second particle, well, maybe there's room for coordination of the outcomes because it was sharing of information. I asked this question here and got this answer. Make sure yours lines up.
Yep.
Now, and so that's what became known as the locality loophole. It's very hard to address experimentally. In the early years, it was really technically a great challenge. But the thing was, if you don't take that into account, then you're not proving a violation of Bell's inequality if you nonetheless find strong correlations, if you don't have the right space-time arrangement of each relevant event in your experiment. They play these games over and over again throughout the 70s. Another one that they came up with that Bell himself had overlooked, and it was pointed out by people like John Clauser, Abner Shimon, Michael Horn, about a dozen years after Bell first published his theorem, published in 1976, in a little out-of-the-way place, a little newsletter, was something that comes to be called today the freedom of choice loophole. It has other names. That's what it's often called. This is not about the flow of information during a given experiment. Did detector A message detector B? But it's instead about shared common causes. Could there have been any subtle influence or event that you otherwise hadn't taken into account that could have nudged or previewed the series of questions to be asked at each detector in advance without changing what can do, even if you know what questions will be asked when, and then could have communicated that in advance to the source of entangled particles before the particles are emitted? In that case, it's like getting a copy of a pop quiz the night before, right? If you know exactly the order of what questions will be asked when, then you and your twin at home can say, okay, this one is going to hear, let's make sure our answers line up. Now they leave on the school bus stop. You know, so it's no longer mysterious. It's consistent with Einstein's principles to have strong correlations. If there was some flow of information, not during the conduct of an experiment, but from some shared causal, common cause before. And so that's what got my colleagues and me really excited. That's what we wound up thinking about after I'd written this book on the history of entanglement and Bell's theorem. And this was with Andy Friedman and Jason Colicchio originally. They were very good friends in graduate school. Andy had just come to MIT to start a postdoc with me working on other aspects of cosmology. We thought we'd work on dark energy and stuff. But so Andy read my history book and got kind of intrigued by it. And we all began talking about, could we address this really stubborn, the kind of last of the most stubborn loopholes in Bell tests, using what we now know as astrophysicists and cosmologists about the large-scale structure of the cosmos since the Big Bang? This point in space-time could not have shared a single light beam with that point in space-time. That kind of question, which is something that's kind of bread and butter for cosmologists today, wasn't so common or certainly not as well-known or constrained in the 1960s or 70s. So we wrote up a proposal, a whole article wound up coming out in PhysRev Letters, saying if we use very distant astronomical objects like high redshift quasars on opposite sides of the sky, and we trigger in real time on some measurement of that astrophysical light, let's say quasar A over here, its light was emitted most of the history of the universe ago. Mm-hmm. It's so far away from us now. The light we measure now in a telescope had been traveling for 8 billion, 12 billion years out of a 14 billion year universe, that kind of thing. You measure it in a tiny fraction of a second here on Earth, and you perform something like the color of that light. Is it more red or more blue than average for that quasar? So you do some prep ahead of time. Here's the typical spectrum for that quasar. Is the light you measure right now more red or more blue than that average one? Okay. Do the same exercise with a different, very carefully chosen quasar on the opposite side of the sky, whose light is coming toward, can be measured at detector B. These are now separated on the face of the Earth. And likewise ask, is that light in that tiny microsecond more red or more blue? You perform these real-time updates after a pair of entangled particles are prepared in your Earthbound laboratory and sent on their merry way. So the choice of what measurement to perform was not knowable even in principle at the time the entangled particles were emitted.
Interesting.
So sometimes people get a little confused. I think we're measuring entanglement from the sky. I wish. That's right. Also a cool question that I'm interested in. That's a separate thing. Here, what we're doing is using as thoroughly unentangled, as uncorrelated random bit streams as possible.
So it's just a way of you saying, look, we need distant observers or distant people to choose the measurement. Let's use the quasars.
And that's right. In a way that information about that choice could not have been previewed or whispered in the ear of any other part of the experiment ahead of time.
This was just a teaser. The full podcast is in the description. If you're hungry for deeper dives into physics, AI, consciousness, philosophy, along with my personal reflections, you'll find it all on my Substack. Subscribers get first access to new episodes, new posts as well, behind-the-scenes insights, and the chance to be a part of a thriving community of like-minded pilgrimers. By joining, you'll directly be supporting my work and helping keep these conversations at the cutting edge. So click the link on screen here, hit subscribe, and let's keep pushing the boundaries of knowledge together. Thank you and enjoy the show. Just so you know, if you're listening, it's curtjaimungal.org, curtjaimungal.org.